I have a message for you. This is I have taken from the book of Acts, but I would like to read a pilot verse that is from the Psalms of 46 verse 1. It's a very popular scripture, Psalms 46 verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. And verse 5, we read that God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. So this is the scripture suddenly came to my mind. I'm not going to speak in detail from the Psalms, but I would like to bring your attention to a person who went through challenges in his life. That person is well known to us, Apostle Paul. His life was full of challenges. But in spite of the challenges that faced in his life, he was successful in his ministry. God called ministry, he was successful because his refuge was none but God. He trusted fully on God. Lord Jesus Christ called him, met him at the gate of Damascus. He had a close encounter with God, with Lord Jesus Christ, and his journey, his Christian journey began from there, and he never turned back. That was a long journey. We are discussing something that happened during the end of his ministry. During the life of Apostle Paul, if you read Romans chapter 1 verse 11, he says that I long to see you that I may impart you some spiritual gift to make you strong. He had a great desire to go to Rome. I planned many times to come to you, but have been prevented from doing so until now. So it was Paul's great desire in his life that he wanted to go to Rome and minister to the people there. He wanted to visit Rome and do the ministry. And again in chapter 15, Romans 15, 24, he says, I plan to do so when I go to Spain. On the way to Spain, he wanted to visit Rome and meet the saints there. That was his long desire in his life. But we know that his desire was accomplished only as a prisoner in his life. He could not go in any of the missionary journey as a normal person to Rome, but his desire was met as a prisoner of God or prisoner of Lord Jesus Christ. And in order to get into Rome, that was his dream and his desire, greatest desire in his life, he had to go through several challenges. Initially in his ministry, we can see Paul went through many, many challenges. I'm not getting into that. But just take this context where Paul is traveling to Rome. Paul had to pass through many obstacles as he was traveling. Christian life is a journey. We are all in that journey. And we have to come across many obstacles, challenges that we face day-to-day basis. In the midst of all these challenges, who is the person we can rely upon? Who is the person we can go and ask for a guidance or a consolation? You know, if we look around the people, everybody has their own challenges. If you meet one person and ask, brother, do you have any challenges? Or you look for someone who doesn't have any challenges in life, you will not find anyone. Everyone has their own challenges in life. All are loaded with full challenges in life. So who is the person we can meet in the midst of our challenges? Our Lord Jesus Christ. He is alone is able to help us. My dear brothers and sisters, you might have come with different challenges in your life. Maybe issues that you cannot discuss with others. Maybe your mind is so much worried about certain issues. It can be financial, it can be health, it can be relationship, it can be some other reasons. Whatever may be the reason, we have come to the right place. We have come to the refuge of our Lord Jesus Christ. This place is holy. His awesome presence is here. You know, it is the promise of our Lord that wherever two or three gather in my name, his presence is there. Yes, if our Lord is in the midst of us, he will do something. Whenever our Lord Jesus Christ enter into a house, if he enter into a person's life, whether it is individual or group or in a house, wherever Jesus entered, something happened. Jesus will never come back without doing the mission that he has to do. If his presence here is clear, he is going to do that. My dear brothers and sisters, whatever the challenges you are going through, at the end we are going to pray for you. May God deal with your situation and make you blessed. So, Apostle Paul had a great desire to be fulfilled in his life. We know that in that journey, he had to go through many challenges. He went to Jerusalem to be in the temple for some rituals. We know that he was arrested from there. From chapter 20, if you read, he is in a trouble. And you know, the Jewish people who are so jealous with Paul, they put a false case, a fake case against him in the court of Festus, the governor. They put a case, they brought one popular lawyer, his name is Tertullus. From the Hellenistic background he has come. They have brought a very popular advocate, and all the Jewish authority, they came together, they have come to the court of Festus, and they say, this man is a heretic, he's a problem maker, he's a ringleader, he's a trouble for this generation, so he must be punished, he must be put to death. So they have brought a false case against Apostle Paul. In chapter 24, read about the detail about that. And Paul says, they have made many accusations against me, but they can prove none. That is the confidence of a child of God. There may be many accusations against you. The devil may bring many accusations against you, but he cannot prove that. Paul says, they cannot prove that. And Paul says, and his life manifesto, he's saying, I believe in God, God of our forefathers. I believe in the scripture. And I believe that there is a resurrection, a day of resurrection is coming. And that is the reason why I am here. He said, I have a good conscience with man and God. I am a man of God. I am on the mission, fulfilling that task. You know that when Paul realized that he is not going to get a justice in the court of Felix, where his case was transferred into the court of Felix, the governor, and he knew that he is not going to get a justice, so he appealed to Caesar. He said, I am a Roman citizen. I would like to appeal to Caesar. From there, the story changed. Yes, you will go to Rome to see Caesar. There, the journey began. And you study chapter 27 and 28. That is the context where we are discussing this thing. So the journey started. Every time the journey began, as they proceed, we can see several ways devil tried to kill him. The enemy tried to kill him. In Acts 23, we read that 40 men conspired against him to kill him. Then we see 27:42, the soldiers in the ship itself wanted to kill Paul and all other prisoners. And we read in other scripture, verse 27:4, 27:7, 27:13, 27:16, we can see different hurricanes, different storm come and hit the ship which he is traveling. The ship was hit by several storms. And something very interesting to notice that whenever his ship was hit by a storm, we see that God made a shelter there to protect this ship. 27:4, we see that God made a shelter of Cyprus, the island Cyprus. 27:7, God provided Crete, another shelter. Then 27:3, again the same island God gave. 27:16, another island God gave as a protection is the island known as Kannada. See how God protect for you. That's why in 1 Corinthians 10:13 we read that no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. Praise the Lord. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. Our God is a God. He will always make a pocket way for you. Even if the temptations come one after another, try to sink you, try to kill you, our God is a God. He's a good God. He will always provide a pocket way for you. And that's what happened in the life of Paul. Several things came. And at the end of the story, we see that a viper bitten him in the island Malta. So these are the some of the things happen at the end of his life on his journey to Rome. They will want to kill him. They will want to stop him from reaching where his desire is. Let me tell you, my dear brothers and sisters, if you have a strong desire for God, if you have a strong desire for the glory of God, and that desire is matching with the plan of God, it will be done. Hallelujah. That's what happened in the life of Apostle Paul. You know, that's why we read in Philippians chapter 1 verse 6, we read that Paul says, the one who has begun a good work in us will carry it on to the completion until the day of Christ Jesus. So in chapter 27 and 28, we can see Paul's four strong refuges that made him to endure through the situation he was going through. What was the refuges he had in his life? Number one, 27:3, we read that he depended on God's presence in his life. Paul is saying, the presence of God came to me last night and spoke to me. Even in this situation, this negative situation, hostile situation, Paul understood that he is not alone. The ship is in trouble. The overall situation is not good. A lot of challenges is going through, but he knew that he was not alone. Paul experienced the presence of the Lord who had come to minister to him amidst of the storms in the sea. As we engage in situations like storms in life, we have guaranteed assurance of the presence of God. Hallelujah. That's what we just read, you know. Jesus said, wherever two or three gather in my name, I am there. And the Great Commission, when Jesus gave it to his disciple, he said, I'll be with you till the ends of the world. I'll be with you. How you understand that? Brother, can you come? You're a wonderful worship leader. In the Great Commission, Jesus said, I'll be with you till the ends of the world. I will not leave you. So what is Great Commission? In the Great Commission, Jesus is asking his disciple, go, preach, baptize, teach, make disciple. I'll be with you. How you understand that verse? So I am asking my brother, Shobin, go, preach, baptize, teach, and make disciples. I am sending him on a commission. He is commissioned to go and fulfill that great commission. So he is ready to go, but I am saying, I will be with you. That means you are not going alone. We will go together. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This is Christian life. Thank you so much. This is Christian life. This is our faith life. Our Lord Jesus Christ, he will never leave you alone. He is not someone you are far away in your troubles and is watching and enjoying. No, no, no. Some people think Jesus is happy that when children go through difficulties. No, he is not like that. He is always with you. He wants to be with you. In the Gospel of Matthew chapter 14, we see that his disciples were already in the middle of the sea. And they were going through storms in life. Difficult time in their life. They were having a great tragedy in their life, expecting they will not see the day because the storm was so great. But we see our Lord Jesus Christ. In the fourth watch of night, he came to them. He walked over the sea and he came to them and he encouraged them and he rebuked the storm. He calmed the sea and he delivered them. Once again, he established through his life that he is the Lord of all creation. Hallelujah. In order to make them known that Jesus is the Lord, Jesus is the ultimate solution of all problem, he revealed himself. My dear brothers and sisters, whatever the storms you are facing, I tell you, our God is greater than our greatest problem in life. Hallelujah. We serve such a wonderful God, and Paul knew that, my God who has called me. Many times we say, you know, I have an encounter with God. Encounter and close encounter are different. Praise the Lord. God has, encounter is what? You come here, you attended church, okay, and the service was good. That is encounter. But close encounter is that is you are experiencing the touch of Jesus in your life. Personally, how you experience it. That is the close encounter come. That is the time you leave where you are. You will forget that where you stand. You will worship God. You will forget about yourself and you will worship God. Sometimes people may jump and dance as they experience the close encounter. They will rejoice in the word of God. They may cry. They see and experience the deliverance in their life. Many people are enjoying, you know, they say we had an encounter. But let me tell you, encounter is not enough that all of us are having, but you need to have a close encounter of Lord Jesus Christ. That is the personal experience that you will have from God. So we see that he is going through a very difficult time, but the presence of God made him strong. And from that moment, he became the leader. He says, everybody, see, don't worry. Last night, the Lord whom I serve, he came to me and talked to me. Nothing is going to happen without his knowledge. One of my teachers who came from America, he shared one of his life story. This man of God, he made a decision in his life that whenever he go for a ministry, the same night he will come back, because he had a small plane. He used to, you know, pilot his own flight, and he used to preach in different part of America. Then he will come back home. He will land in nearby airport, then come home. This is the way he used to do ministry. That is decision that he will come back home and spend the time with his family. So one night, as he was coming from a far distance, and he was supposed to land in a particular airport where he used to land, and he got the information that the hurricane is coming, a storm is coming, he cannot land there. So he didn't get the permission. They said, try the other airport. So he went to the other airport. They also said, no, here also it is closed. You cannot, you try another airport. Then finally, the third time he tried another airport, and what happened? He was in touch with the control tower people there, and he told them, I want to land somewhere. They said, okay, we will help you. Suddenly, he was caught up in the midst of full clouds. He was totally inside the clouds. He cannot see anything. He can only know that he's sitting inside a plane and nothing he can see. It's full cloud all over. He doesn't know to which direction it's moving. So the control tower told him, every 3 minutes you can call us. Every 3 minute call us, we will give you direction. So he was calling every 3 minutes. They will give you, okay, this degree you move, this degree you turn, or this much height, this much distance, you know, feet, you can come down. He was closely following the instruction from the control tower. And the journey went like that for some time. Then they said, okay, come down 1,000 feet. So he came down 1,000 feet. He could see the lights of the runway. He saw the lights and he was so happy. And he said very safely he could come and land in the airport, and he got saved from the storm that he was passing through. And he was saying this, if I started arguing with the control tower, who are you to tell me, call me every 3 minutes? Who are you to tell me, turn to this side, that side? Who are you to control me like that? I need help. Tell me straight away what I have to do. He said, if I started arguing with the control tower, I would have been in trouble. He said, I followed every words that came from the control tower. Let me tell you, my dear brothers and sisters, you and me, we are caught up in storms. You closely be following the voice of God, voice of the Holy Spirit. That is the only source where you can get the relief in your life. That is the only way you can overcome storms like situation in your life. Don't depend on other people, but listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. So the second thing I want to tell you, that is from 27, 24 to 25, we read that he believed in his promises. He believed in the promises of God. He knew that he's on a mission, and God has told him, you will stand before Caesar. That is the promise given to him. You will stand before the Caesar. He has a promise. How many of you have promises from God that I will fulfill in your life? Our God is a promise keeper God. Hallelujah. If he promised, he's going to fulfill that. So Paul was confident that God is a God of promises. He will keep his promises, and he is going to fulfill that. In Romans 4:21, we read, then being fully assured that what he had promised, he was able to perform. In the word of God, we know that the Bible that we carry, there are 31,101 verses. Every verse is a promise. But to say specifically, I studied that there are 8,810 promises in the word of God. Out of that, 7,487 is God to man. 991 man to man. 290 man to God. 29 angel to man. 11 devil to man. And 2 father to son. There are many promises, but our God is a good God, is a promise keeper. if God has promised you something, if God has promised you something on your way, he is going to fulfill it. That's what we read in the book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 3. We read that, for the vision awaits an appointed time. If God has given you a vision, a promise, it will be fulfilled at the appointed right time. So don't get cast away. Never you have the opportunity to doubt him, but trust in him. He will fulfill what he promised in his life. All of you know the story of Pilgrim Progress, a very well-known book written by John Bunyan. You know, he was a Christian. There is a Christian he's talking about. He is looking for the eternal home. In his journey, as he was going, he was caught up in between many, many difficulties. Many, many storms came to him. Many hindrances came that tried to stop him from his journey. And what we see that, he was captured by giant despair. And he put him in a doubting castle. And he thought, oh, my journey is over. I cannot reach the eternal home. My journey is over. So he got into a very miserable situation that he is put in a doubting castle. And it is locked. As he was in that situation, suddenly remembered, on the way, an evangelist gave him a key. So he put his hand in the pocket and took out that key. That key is the promise of God. Hallelujah. Even in the midst of all troubles, if all the doors are closed, you think you cannot escape. My dear brothers and sisters, the promise of God is with you. This is the key. He suddenly used that key and opened that lock the devil has shut, and he came out of. You trust that God has given you a promise and he is going to fulfill that. Chapter 28 verse 12, we see another refuge Paul had. That was, he trusted in God's provisions, not looking at man. As you know, this storm, because of the storm, they emptied all the foodstuff from the ship and they are without any food. All their personal belongings, everything is lost. And you know, when they reach the island Malta, they were just having only the dress that they had. They did not have anything. Empty-handed, they come to that island. But Paul knew that his God is a good God. He will provide everything that is needed in his life. We know that when they reach Malta, the people of Malta, they show compassion, unusual kindness to Paul and the companions. Our God is a good God. He will provide that he has promised you. If you depend upon him, if your trust is on him, he will provide. I am in the ministry for long years. I have seen how wonderfully God has led me through. I have many stories to tell you. If you go and ask people to help you, people cannot help you. There is a limitation. Even if they help you, they will tell it to 10 people. But our God is a good God. He is the giver. When he opened the door, you cannot match that with anything others. So in the time of Reformation, I read that Emperor Charles V, he was trying to assassinate John Bruns, a friend of Martin Luther. So the soldiers came to catch him to the village where he is. So they came and looking for John Bruns, the evangelist. They look all over the village and they could not find him. Suddenly, what he did is suddenly he went inside the godown where the hay and the fodder for the animals are kept. He went inside and hid himself. He was hiding himself. 14 days he was hiding himself there. As he was running into the hiding place, he took out a piece of bread and little water, and that finished on the same day. He did not know how to survive in the situation of no food. He is hiding there because the soldiers are there in the place looking every nook and corner. And what happened? He is saying, the story says like this, every day one hen will come at the very back of this godown where he is hiding. The hen will come and lay one egg. So he said he will take it, open it slowly, taste it, because he has 24 hours to have that one egg. So this is the way he survived 14 days. On the 15th day, he overheard a voice outside, where is this man? Soldiers came and left, but he is still hiding somewhere. Then he came out. Hallelujah. My dear brothers and sisters, in your challenges, in the storm, our God is a good God. He will provide all your need that is needed to you. And finally, verse from chapter 28, 1 to 6, we read that he experienced God's power in the midst of evils. We see that when they reach the island Malta, a venomous viper fastened on the hand of Paul, which persuaded many to anticipate death or collapse of Paul and his ministry. New Living Translation, we read that a poisonous snake driven out by the heat bit on his hand. He was bitten by this poisonous. We see it's a viper, blood viper. People see that, he will get swelled and start bleeding, will start, he will collapse and die. You and me are God's servants. When people are waiting to see that this man will collapse and die now, but what did he do? He shook that snake in the fire. In the power of the Holy Spirit, you have the deliverance. Everyone who comes to this church must be filled by the Spirit. The work of the Holy Spirit only can stop you from demonic activity that happened in our life. We have a lot of testimonies to tell how God wonderfully worked, you know, in our life. When devil tried to stop you, in Luke 10:19, we read that God has given, Jesus says, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. Praise the Lord. Yeah, Isaiah 54:17, we read, no weapon against you which formed by devil will not harm you. We are very precious for God. When Satan had an eye on Job, God is asking, did you have an eye on my servant? That is the relationship we have with God. When devil want to put his eye on Job, who is very favorite or who is very intimate to God, God says, did you have a look on him? Without the permission of God, devil cannot touch you. That is the relationship you and me as the children of God. Hallelujah. So God has filled us with the Spirit. 2 Timothy 1:7. For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. Let us submit our hearts to Jesus. Just as the Paul, he depended upon God's presence in his life. He believed in God's promises. He trusted in God's provisions. And he experienced God's power, the power of the Holy Spirit, in the midst of evils.